ladies and gentlemen. We have gathered here to witness the launching of a new and inspiring contribution by the Goa University in the field of education and learning through the Visiting Research Professorship Program. Today's ceremony is presided over by the Honorable Governor of Goa and Chancellor of Goa University, Shri Bharat Veer Vanchu. As in Hindi they say, Sone Pe Suhaga. While we are a part of this ceremony, we are privileged to interact with the renowned historian of India, Professor Romila Thapar, while she talks on the subject, Contours in Reading Early Indian History. I now request Professor N.S. Bhatt, respected Dean, Faculty of Social Sciences, Goa University, to kindly present a formal welcome to all the dignitaries and guests.
Respected dignitaries on the dais, invitees, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon to you all. I have the pleasant task of welcoming all of you who have responded to our invitation to participate in this significant event, the inauguration of a novel academic initiative of Goa University. At the outset, let me extend a warm welcome to Sri Bharat Veer Vanchu, Governor of Goa and Chancellor of Goa University, who has consented to preside over this program and deliver the presidential address. In fact, the Honorable Chancellor has been a great source of guidance and support in this venture. Next, I extend a warm welcome to Professor Romila Thapar, D.D. Kosambi Visiting Professor at Goa University. She is our chief guest today to launch the Visiting Research Professorship Program with the inaugural lecture on Contours in Reading Early Indian History. It is heartening to note that an eminent historian is invited to inaugurate this event by lecturing on a historical topic. I welcome Dr. Satish R. Shetty, Vice Chancellor, Goa University, due to whose initiative this event is taking place today. I extend warm welcome to Dr. Maria Arora Kuto, Chairperson, Standing Committee of the University to select visiting research professors for the 6 chairs at the university. The hard work of the committee has helped us in organizing this program. I welcome Professor V.P. Kamath, Registrar, Goa University. I extend warm welcome to the members of the university bodies, deans of faculties, heads of departments, principals of the affiliated colleges, directors of the affiliated institutions, faculty colleagues, administrative officers and staff, eminent citizens of Goa, officials of the government of Goa, invitees and dear students. Warm welcome to the members of the media. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, on behalf of Goa University and on my behalf, I welcome each one of you present over here. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. When a new and novel idea takes a concrete shape, it is necessary that it should be precisely communicated and conveyed to everyone. As the idea of the Visiting Research Professorship Program comes to life today, I request respected Vice Chancellor of Goa University, Dr. Satish R. Shetye, to kindly introduce the proposed program to our guests.
Honorable Governor of Goa and Chancellor of Goa University, Sri Bharat Veer Vanchu, Professor Romila Thapar, Dr. Maria Kuto, Professor Vijayendra Kamath, Professor N.S. Bhatt, members of university bodies, principals, members of faculties, students, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Goa University is today launching a new program, Visiting Research Professorship Program, with a lot of enthusiasm and hope that it will bring new intellectual experience to the students and members of the faculty on this campus, to the students and faculty in our 50-odd affiliated colleges, and to the citizens of the state. I would like to share with you briefly the evolution of this project that has brought us to this day. In 2007, the birth centenary year of the great Goan polymath, Professor Damodar Dharmananda Kosambi, the Department of Arts and Culture, Government of Goa, under the able leadership of its director, Shri Prasad Lolyankar, and with some coaxing from Dr. Maria Couto mooted the idea of having a chair professorship in interdisciplinary studies at Goa University. It was proposed that it should be named after Professor Kosambi. Sometime later in 2010, the birth centenary year of the great Goan poet Bakiba Borkar, and in 2011, the birth centenary year of Goa's great leader and first chief minister, Sri Dayananda Bandodkar, two more chairs were suggested. One in comparative literature named after Bakibab, and one in political economy named after Bhausaheb Bandodkar. In 2012, three more chairs were added: Mario Miranda Chair in Arts, Anthony Gosalvis Chair in Western Music, and Nana Shirgaonkar Chair in Traditional Music. The original idea behind instituting of these professorships was to attract academics of repute to serve as full-time professors on the campus of Goa University. It turned out, however, that well-established academics were reluctant to relocate to Goa as full-time faculty. The Executive Council of Goa University deliberated on this issue, and then, in consultation with the Department of Art and Culture, decided to convert these full-time chairs into visiting research professorships. In the present format of this program, an academic is invited to spend approximately 6 to 12 weeks at Goa University every year for about 3 years. The Executive Council oversees this program through its recently created Standing Committee on the Program. The committee is chaired by Dr. Maria Couto and has Sri Ramchandra B. Dinar Bhatkar, Professor YVB Reddy, Sri PFX De Lima, and Sri Ranjit Hoskot as members. The committee works in close collaboration with the Directorate of Art and Culture, which has earmarked close to a crore of rupees per year for this program. During the last 3 months since the committee came into existence, we all have been pleasantly surprised at the response that this program has received from academics, writers, performers, and other creative and accomplished leaders in different fields. I think there are two major factors that have helped the program. First, the tireless effort put in by Dr. Couto using her personal network to attract distinguished academics to the program. Second, the leadership that Sri Lolyankar has shown to allow the flexibility that the program needs for it to succeed. I'm indeed grateful to both of them. I think yet another factor that has helped us is what Goa offers to its visitors: the beauty of our land and the reputation as a people-friendly place. With regard to the program, a relevant question to ask on this occasion is, what does the student of Goa University get from it? Let me try to answer it. We are requesting each visiting professor to offer a course that carries 1 or 2 credits. A 1-credit course is normally associated with 15 hours of classroom teaching. We leave it to the visiting professor to decide what should be the nature of his or her teaching and evaluation in the class. We are confident, however, that our visiting professors will offer something that the students in India do not generally have access to. Consider a typical student studying for her or his master's degree on this campus. We hope that during the 2-year period of study, that the student will have the opportunity to listen, perhaps work, or perform with at least 6 personalities who have distinguished themselves in their creativity innovation, and sheer gumption to produce something new. These qualities, creativity, innovation, and gumption, are not easy to teach in a classroom. They have to be picked up in the company of the masters. It is our hope that this program will give our students an opportunity to see the masters in action at first hand. We do not want to restrict this program to the students enrolled on this campus alone. We want to make it available across all our affiliated colleges and open it to the public at large. I see every reason why some of the colleges should coordinate some of the courses offered by the visiting professors. We are also making the courses offered by the visiting professors open to the interested citizens of the state of Goa. Those who go through a course successfully will be eligible for a certificate of participation signed by the professor. What we are launching today is an experiment. We, students, members of the faculty, and Goan society at large will need to struggle to make the experiment work. We have faith that the experiment will lead to an intellectually more vibrant campus that will resonate with our colleges and with Goa. There are no easy prescriptions on how to go about achieving the goals we have set for this experiment. Only some vague guidelines exist. Let me share one such guideline that came our way earlier this year when Professor Govardhan Mehta was our annual convocation speaker. While advising us on how we might go about shaping our visiting research professorship program, he said, and I quote, "Rope in the best, then give them the freedom to do their stuff. Desired result will follow naturally," unquote. He further said, when he launched a visiting professorship program at the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, he invited Professor Romila Thapar to participate in the program. On receiving his call, Professor Thapar asked him what he expected her to do on a campus which is filled with scientists and engineers. Professor Mehta told Professor Thapar that it would be enough if she merely walked on the campus. The rest would follow, and it did. Professor Thapar, we are indeed happy that you decided to walk on this campus this week. And that you have accepted our D.D. Kosambi Visiting Research Professorship. We are confident that the rest would happen naturally. Welcome to Goa University. I thank you all for your attention. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. What you decide today shall determine what you would be tomorrow. As the Visiting Research Professorship Program is launched today, it has specific goals and objectives to pursue in future. And to acquaint us to the present status and future prospects of the program, I hand over the mic to Dr. Maria Kuto, respected chairperson of the Standing Committee constituted by the Executive Council to oversee the Visiting Research Professorship Program.
Your Excellency, Sri Bharat Veeravanchu, Governor of Goa and Chancellor of Goa University, respected Professor Romila Thapar, distinguished historian, respected Professor Satish Shetye, Vice Chancellor of Goa University, Professor Vijayendra Kamath, Professor N.S. Bhatt, members of university boards and bodies, principals, members of the various faculties, students, ladies and gentlemen. I feel deeply honored to be here to talk briefly about the Visiting Research Professors Program. First of all, I must laud the University of Goa, I'm sorry, the government of Goa, for this windfall meant to advance scholarship through intellectual and cultural interaction with some of the most eminent scholars and artists in the country and beyond. I say beyond because even without asking formally, and I shan't mention names, I've had messages from historians from outside saying, you know, we would be happy to do something for you. And for you doesn't mean me, but Goa University. However, the program we are inaugurating today would not have been possible without the vision and total commitment of Professor Shetye and the wholehearted encouragement of Sri Vanshu, the Chancellor of the University. For me, this program, and I'm sure most of you know about this, is in every sense a continuation of what we started 7 years ago when we were celebrating the centenary of D.D. Kosambi. Indeed, for me, the name D.D. Kosambi seems to have a talismanic quality, a charm that brings together the best minds, the idea of interdisciplinary study, and a passion for Goa, whose creative spirit has stayed alive through the many phases of our history. The first person I had called in 2007, the year of the centenary, was Professor Romila Thapar, and her response was enthusiastic and inspirational, an inspiration that has stayed with me. I recall that I followed her on email as she moved up and down the country and around the world to see that she landed here on time. Crucial to the success of that program was our dynamic director of art and culture, Prasad Lolekar, and the Kosambi Festival of Ideas was launched. The rest, as they say, is history created by Prasad and his team. In the case of filling these chairs again, the first person I called was Professor Thapar, and her response, as usual, was heartwarming. She even agreed to come in July despite the weather. Speaking on behalf of the government, Prasad Lolekar has allowed the university to be flexible, and so we have been able to tweak our own programs to suit the problems faced by the visitors. I have given Professor Shetye, the Vice Chancellor, very little rest. I have pursued him with emails, with phone calls, and SMSs, and I've given him no time asking for an immediate response. And I must say, he has responded always with patience and grace. I'm grateful to the members of the Standing Committee with whom I've discussed these lists before putting them together, and to a few members of the faculty, Alit Sikera, Pranav Mukhopadhyay, and Nandkumar Mekot, who have worked with enthusiastic diligence to see that this path-breaking program takes off. We are quickly learning that public participation is vital in organizing the events associated with these chairs. If not for the intense involvement of Dr. Louise Dheeraj from Child's Play India, we would not have had the range and depth of the course offered by Professor Lusardi and his team. I'd like to thank the Deputy Registrar, Sridhara, Venkatesh Kamath, Ramrao Vag, and faculty who have offered to be hosts and coordinators like Shaila D'Souza, Maris de Lima, Usha Muridharan, and Parab Parab. And I request you, since many of you from the faculty are here, to please come forward and give your names as coordinators and hosts, because without you, this program cannot be a success. We have to have hosts and coordinators who will liaise with our visitors and see that everything moves smoothly. Given the enormous energy a creative movement like this generates, I know that the registrar, Professor Kamath, would be looking for innovative, administrative, and financial channels to support and facilitate the new initiatives of the Visiting Research Professors Program, and also that Professor Butt and his department will benefit from the presence of Professor Thapar over the next 3 years and will work to take the historiography of Goa to another level. To both of them, many thanks in anticipation. Without giving him much time, I'd requested Alit Sikera to give me a short note on what faculty hopes to achieve. With his permission, I have added elements from his proposals to details of courses which I'd like to share with you. Our visiting professors are informed by a vision of new and creative demands from knowledge in an increasingly challenging world. The program will not just enhance, but also integrate across disciplines and faculties into curricular and extracurricular activities in order to make Goa a learning society. Goa University now has an increasing number of students who will be the first graduates in their families. Many come from interior villages, and a large number of them are women. These young persons enter the university with great dreams and aspirations for a better life. But at the same time, they face personal and global challenges that we, the adults of today, cannot even or have never imagined. Their quest for employment and income is threatened by crises in development, in environment, and challenges like the limits to growth. Skills which were once relied on for a lifetime of work are becoming redundant at an increasing pace. Young persons must be prepared to continuously reinvent not just themselves, but help to reinvent a world which is threatened with environmental, social, economic, and political strife. These young persons will be the politicians and shapers of tomorrow and have to face today's questions, the answers to which we do not have. It is true that the basic foundation skills taught by a discipline are absolutely essential, as much as critical thinking brought in by the social sciences. But we do need imagination that is fostered by the arts. The university needs to grow in these significant directions. It needs to encourage its students to be creators of knowledge. Significant contributions in this direction will be Professor Madhav Gadgil, who is exploring how to integrate undergraduate and postgraduate dissertation project work of students into a contribution to a book titled Peoplescape, a proposed study of Goa's ecological history over the last 50 years. Professor Amit Bahaduri's course is a perspective on globalization, which will combine theories, evidence, and Indian experience. The graphic designer Orjit Sen is imagining a project called Mapping Mapsa Market. It is an ongoing participatory process which will eventually build a dedicated website accessible to the public. The main idea behind this project is to explore and document the complex life of Mapsa Market from a variety of perspectives through illustrations, photographs, videos, recorded interviews, and data gathering. It is visual sociology in a way. This is incidentally also a fitting tribute to Mario Miranda, who was so obsessive in his caricature of the village public space, of which Mapsa Market, as you know, is the iconic case. Sen will also explore the possibility of exposing students to the graphic narrative format, where they could engage in documenting local histories, such as those of tribal or other communities. What is novel in these programs is that the students are going to create knowledge artifacts from books to websites that have general public utility. In some way, this is a postmodern version of the old apprentice and learn while you produce orientation, a partial drift away from the ivory tower integrating social science, art, aesthetics, and technology. One of the most popular courses will be that designed by Shubha Mudgal, on diversity, hybridity, and experimentation in the music of contemporary India. Using audio and video references, she will discuss notions of purity, fusion, and film music as hybrid forms and much else. Art historian Professor Jyotinder Jain's course is on the power of the visual in Indian culture. This multidisciplinary course is aimed at a critical study of contemporary visual culture comprising the printed image, photography, propaganda industries, fashion, and visual culture around trade and urbanism. It will explore the role of the visual image, its genealogy, its social context, and its political significance. Sudhir Kakkar's Psychology and Humanities will be a seminar course on how depth psychology can contribute to an understanding of society, literature, and history. Besides introductory lectures, it would basically comprise discussions of assigned readings and essays by students for evaluation. The university then must see itself as the hub of the knowledge presumption, production and consumption integrated as above for the whole state. As a first phase, the university has two aims. The first, to underscore that every citizen has a right to learning from the best in the field, and thus to throw open the courses and activities of the visiting professors to the public as much as possible. The second is that all these courses will be 1 credit, 15 contact hour courses for students. Participants from the public will get participation certificates. The Academic Council of the university will monitor these efforts over the semester and decide how best the program could help the university to develop a genuine credit system where citizens at their own pace, their own time and place, both in the real and virtual world, could earn credits. These could be then aggregated into diplomas, and diplomas in turn into degrees. The decision to introduce fine arts, music, and aesthetics is informed by the perspective that they bring to life different ways of knowing and being. They provide solace in times of stress, and equally importantly, they fire the imagination to dream of different futures. It is once again rather fitting that the first such course will be music, that creative domain which has given us Jugalbandi and fusion. Because of his association with El Sistema, I believe that it is more than a mere coincidence that Professor Santiago Lusard Girelli is the first Anthony Gonsalves visiting professor of Western music. The El Sistema was able to take highbrow classical music to slum children in the belief, and I quote, that music was to be recognized as an agent of social development in the highest sense because it transmits the highest values, solidarity, harmony, mutual compassion, and it has the ability to unite an entire community and to express sublime feelings, unquote. Who can doubt that this vision embodies the voice and spirit of a number of Goan musicians, not just Western, such as Chick Chocolate and Anthony Gonsalves, but also the numerous renowned vocalists, Kesarbhai Kherkar, Mogubhai Kurdikar, Kishori Amonkar, Dinanath Mangeshkar, and his daughters, Lata and Asha, Usha and Meena. We are deeply encouraged that every one of those we invited had welcomed this program. This makes us believe we are in the right direction, but there are uncertainties too. How will young people take this initiative? Will they be enthused with this learning adventure? Will the public welcome this initiative by attending courses offered? We would like to spread out to other disciplines and intelligences, science, mathematics, and dance. We need public support and participation. We hope the courses will meet what they promise and much more. All of us who have worked to make this happen feel privileged to be associated with Goa University and its faculty and its students at this moment. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. When the personality is as eminent and celebrated as Professor Romila Thapar, indeed an introduction to her would become rather just a formality. Yet, Aditi Silvera and Aluska Lawrence are here to recapitulate the incredible, or perhaps indelible, life and achievements of Professor Romila Thapar that shaped the icon within her. Aditi and Aluska, kindly take over.
Dr. Romila Thapar is one of the most celebrated historians of India. She was born in Lucknow and currently lives in New Delhi. Her principal area of study is ancient Indian history. She is a public intellectual of great standing, having concerned herself with issues of history and culture. She has spoken on and written for many public forums on history, religion, and culture. She has been very outspoken against chauvinist and parochial approaches in history and has been a champion of the secular and scientific approach. After graduating from Punjab University, she earned her doctorate by working with A.L. Basham at the School of Oriental and African Studies, the University of London, in 1958. She served as professor of ancient Indian history at the University of New Delhi, at the Center of Historical Studies, and at Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi, where she is a professor emerita. Her research and teaching career has spanned over four decades. Dr. Thapar's major works include Ashoka and the Decline of the Mauryas, Ancient Indian Social History, Some Interpretations, A History of India, Volume 1, Early India, From the Origins to AD 1300, The Mauryas Revisited, Cultural Pasts, Essays in Early Indian History, and others.
Dr. Thapar has also been a visiting professor at Cornell University, the University of Pennsylvania, and the College de France in Paris. She was elected General President of the Indian History Congress in 1983. And a corresponding fellow of the British Academy in 1999. She is an honorary fellow at the Lady Margaret Hall, Oxford, and at the School of Oriental and African Studies, University of London. She holds honorary doctorates from the University of Chicago, L'Institut National des Langues et Civilisations Orientales in Paris, the University of Oxford and the University of Edinburgh, the University of Calcutta and the University of Hyderabad. She was elected a foreign honorary member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences in 2009. In 2004, the US Library of Congress appointed her as the first holder of the Kluge Chair in Countries and Cultures of the South. She's the co-winner with Peter Brown of the prestigious Kluge Prize for the Study of Humanity. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Romila Thapar.
Thank you, Aditi and Aluska. Ladies and gentlemen, we shall now begin with a lecture by Professor Romila Thapar on the subject Contours in Reading Early Indian History, and followed by the interactive session. I welcome Professor Thapar and request her to address the keen audience.
Your Excellency, Governor Vanchu, Mr. Vice-Chancellor, Professor Kamath, Professor Bhatt, the faculty and students of Goa University, and ladies and gentlemen. Let me begin by saying that I do regard it indeed as an extremely great honor to have been invited to take up this visiting chair at Goa University, named after Professor D.D. Kosambi. His work on early history has been much admired all over the world, and for me at least, he was one of my earliest mentors from the days when I first started working on early Indian history. I never had a formal position working with him or anything. Our interaction consisted of the best kind of interaction, which was casual chatting about the problems that I was constantly coming up with and which he would occasionally have the patience to discuss with me. I think that the creation of these chairs is really in many ways a fantastic idea. Fantastic because Goa University is the only university in this country that has these chairs. And the reason why I accepted immediately the moment Mrs. Kuto rang me up was because I thought it was really a most unusual thing for a university to do, and I was intrigued to see as to how it would work out, and I now feel that it was really an excellent idea and quite likely to work out very well. So whoever was responsible, and I think Mrs. Kuto had a lot to do with it, I would like to say that this really was an absolute godsend of an idea. Let me also add that in our discussion of why it is important and the effect that it might have, I would also like to say that universities in this country tend to be self-sustained institutions with no contact between one university and another. And I think that this is in many ways tragic, because every university cannot be a center of excellence in every subject and discipline and sub-discipline under the sun. There has to be a certain amount of specialization. And so if there is a certain coming and going, some degree of exchange of students, of faculty, of the availability of expertise from one university to another, I think that the end result can only be a positive result. And therefore, I do want to begin by offering my deep congratulations to the Goa University for having started this system of visiting professorships. Professor Didi Kosambi, although by profession a mathematician of considerable distinction, was nevertheless interested in the ancient past. This interest took the form of a remarkable series of papers and later monographs of detailed research, some on archaeology and more often on history. These created what I have called elsewhere in an article a paradigm shift in the study of ancient Indian history. Thomas Kuhn, who wrote a book called The Structure of Scientific Revolutions, writes about paradigm shifts in scientific research and scientific thought. And he argues that knowledge advances through the asking of new questions and seeking fresh answers, working through different frameworks from the earlier ones, and thus shifting what he calls the paradigm. Further, that this is not the isolated activity of individual scientists, it's also influenced by the intellectual world of the particular scientist. And I would like to say that this applies not only to science, it applies to all branches of knowledge. Let's look for a moment at the intellectual world of Didi Kosambi. We are all familiar with this world. There was his father's interest, really quite a remarkable interest, in Pali texts and Buddhism, where he walked the entire countryside of India in search of a Pali teacher. And his own, Didi Kosambi's own years in Harvard, his pursuit of theoretical problems in mathematics, and his discovery of Marxism as a way of analyzing the past and the present. And the way he links the past and the present is something that we all need to think about very carefully. We should perhaps also keep in mind that these decades of the 1940s and 50s, when he was doing the maximum amount of his writing, were the time when scientists were discussing the question of whether the sciences and the humanities constituted two distinctive cultures or were two sides of the same culture. Kosambi's work shows an immense integration of both, and this is reflected in his contribution to both mathematics and history. Let me now turn to the question of the paradigm shift and how he asked questions and suggested answers that changed the way in which we began to pursue our study of early history. The use of a method derived from Marxist thinking did enable him to ask new questions of his data. Nevertheless, there was a broader process involved in his historical thinking, and this enriched his search for fresh answers. His reading was extraordinarily wide, and he had a remarkably impressive intellectual reach. It's the kind of reach that many of us would give our left hands for, if not our right hands. This enabled him to go beyond the way in which early history had been interpreted in the past. In order to understand the change, I would like to begin with describing the earlier interpretation of ancient history and then refer to the changes that were introduced in the last few decades, which many of which changes reflect Kosambi's ideas. At the time of Indian independence, 60 years ago, we had inherited a history of the subcontinent contoured by two substantial views of the past, the colonial and the nationalist. Both were primarily concerned with chronology and with sequential narratives. The focus was on those in power a focus that has been basic to much historical writing of the period up to that time. There was information on the action of kings and dynasties, on governors general and viceroys, and on various national leaders. On most of these, there was broad agreement. What was contested, although only partially, was the colonial representation of early Indian society. The colonial view drew on European preconceptions of Indian history. The use of history to legitimize power had changed, since power now lay not in the rule of dynasties, but in colonial and nationalistic definitions of power. As far as colonial scholarship was concerned, there were three arguments that were foundational to that view. The first was that Indian history was divided into three periods, three divisions for convenience sake, the Hindu and the subsequent Muslim civilization, and then the British period as formulated in these three divisions by James Mill in his History of British India, published in about 1818. These labels were taken from the religions of the ruling dynasties, first the Hindu and then the Muslim. The divisions were endorsed by the assumption that the units of Indian society have always been monolithic religious communities, primarily the Hindu and the Muslim, and that these communities were mutually hostile right through history. These identities of the religious community were said to have superseded all other identities. This periodization of Hindu, Muslim, and British colored the understanding of Indian history and had a major role to play in the partition of India in 1947, justifying the two-nation theory. The second assumption in colonial scholarship was that the pre-colonial political economy through the centuries conformed to the model of what was called Oriental despotism. This assumed a static society, completely unchanging through the centuries, characterized by an absence of private property in land, despotic and oppressive rulers, and therefore endemic poverty. A static society meant that it lacked a sense of history, since history records change. Historical writing is all about how things have changed. And consequently, it was said that there was no historical writing in pre-modern India. Indian history, therefore, needed to be discovered by colonial scholars. In other words, it needed to be written in accordance with colonial policy. The third argument was that Hindu society has always been divided into four main castes, the Varnas. These were rigidly separated because they represented the diverse races of the subcontinent. The identification of caste with race resulted from current European ideas of the late 19th century, where there was this theory of race science and the labeling of people by race labels. This caste organization of society was said to be rooted in what was seen as the Aryan foundations of Indian civilization, foundations that had been established, according to them, by something called the Aryan race. Above all, the attempt was to project India as culturally alien, the other of Europe. It was also claimed that these colonial interpretations were applying the criteria of Enlightenment rationality in their histories of the colony. But in effect, they were imposing a history that suited the requirements of colonial dominance. These preconceptions, together with a focus on chronology and the narrative of dynasties, governed routine history. Colonial historians drew on texts reflecting the upper caste perspectives of Indian society. And many Indian historians coming from the newly emerged middle class were of the upper castes and familiar with these texts. But by and large, they continued the same routine. The periodization given by the British was generally accepted, as it still is at the popular level. You still hear of people talking about the Hindu period and the Muslim period, whereas historians have given up this periodization. Some altered the nomenclature from Hindu, Muslim, and British to ancient, medieval, and modern, borrowed from Europe and thought to be more secular, although the markers of change remained the same. In effect, therefore, there was very little change. The more nationalist Indian historians naturally rejected the theory of Oriental despotism as a system of political economy. Curiously, however, there was very little interest in providing alternative hypotheses about the early Indian economy and society. This interest began to develop relatively late, in fact, not till about the 1970s. Social history in standard works largely repeated the description of the four castes as given in the normative texts, the ancient Dharma Shastras. There was little recognition of how the system actually worked with its many deviations from the norm. The predominant form of nationalism, described as anti-colonial and secular, was beginning to be imprinted on Indian historical writing from the late 19th century. In opposing some aspects of colonial scholarship, it gave rise to a school of nationalist historians. But parallel to this, and initially less apparent in historical writing, were two ideologies that claimed to be representing the Hindus and the Muslims through two religious nationalisms. Both had been deeply influenced by the colonial projection of monolithic and segregated communities of Hindus and Muslims in the Indian past. Such nationalisms were not essentially anti-colonial and were more interested in using history to legitimize their own political ideology of religion-based nationalism and to thus endorse the political mobilization that they sought. And remember, of course, history is extremely central to nationalist ideology. And this is part of the reason why, in a post-nationalist phase, many of the major controversies are controversies over history, because it is history that gives legitimacy to certain kinds of nationalism. Muslim religious nationalism defined the identity of Pakistan. Hindu religious nationalism is still seeking a parallel identity for India. The agenda and aspirations of colonial policy were and are apparent in these views. But other writing pointed to the need to examine history in terms of a substantially different set of parameters, leading eventually to history becoming a social science in India. The prehistory of the social sciences in India had begun in discussions around questions of the nature of Indian society and the cause of Indian poverty. Economists such as Dadabhai Nauroji had maintained that the colonial economy had drained the wealth of India, and that was the real source of Indian poverty. This raised heated controversies over the nature of the colonial economy. And this, again, encouraged historians to study pre-modern economies of India. Also at the same time, sorting out the strands of the caste structure and its social implications became evident in the writings of sociologists such as D.P. Mukherjee and N.K. Bose, who were trying to unfreeze, as it were, this theoretical pattern of how caste society functioned. And discovering the reality of caste as it actually functioned led to recognizing how it differed from the ideal theoretical description in the Dharmashastras. The conventional view tied Indian civilization to caste and religion as its enduring features, and therefore refrained from questioning the social role of either. It was B.R. Ambedkar who, writing on the history of the Shudras and Dalits, projected his Dalit awareness back into history. And for him, the social hierarchy of caste was linked to issues of domination and subordination, which became central in his writing. But historians of the ancient period were hesitant to go beyond the normative texts and the conventional reading of caste tied to religion continued. Among the more influential colonial views of world history was the division of the world into discrete monolithic civilizations. Each civilization was demarcated territorially and associated with a single language and a single religion. Indian civilization was defined as extending over the subcontinent with Sanskrit as its language and Hinduism as its religion. The lower castes and the forest peoples, the scheduled castes and tribes, were what the British referred to as the lesser breeds without the law. They were looked upon as primitive, and that is a label that still lingers at the popular level. Cultural nationalism, with its popular appeal, was molded by colonial readings of Indian civilization that were largely accepted by most Indians, as sadly they often continue to be. Few thought it necessary to investigate the complexities and multiple forms taken by pre-colonial culture. The simplistic definitions given by colonial scholarship were maintained. It was a category of nationalism that claimed to be concerned only with culture, but culture was defined largely in religious terms. Culture became the label for various diverse identities and their politics. Cultural nationalism, therefore, stayed close to the contours dictated by colonial interpretations. The claims frequently made today by groups to some particular identities being authentic, indigenous, unchanging, and eternal pose immense problems for historians. Identities, let us remember, are neither timeless and unchanging, nor homogeneous, nor singular, as maintained in the 19th century concept of civilization. In every society, historians have discovered, identities are multiple. A particular identity, be it an identity of religion, language, caste, ethnicity, or whatever, has relevance to particular situations and events. Historians cannot treat one identity as primary for all time, for all situations. Many parts of the world today, right across the globe, resonate with cultural nationalism of the kind I have described. This claims to draw on indigenous history, And it is often said that the new history is untouched by Western and European ideas. But the very process of constructing a history requires an awareness of earlier interpretations of history and the basis on which these were constructed. This is my justification for giving the kind of talk that I am giving. This makes us aware of how the present influences the readings of the past and the awareness required by historians to recognize this influence. The understanding of how nationalisms of various kinds are constructed has to include a critical inquiry into pre-modern history. The questioning of existing theories about the past began to be more distinctly formulated in the 1950s and the 1960s, at a time when other social sciences were also becoming prominent. This gradually altered the kinds of questions historians asked of their data. The range of sources slowly got widened. It also led to a distancing from colonial views and from those nationalist interpretations that were derived from the colonial, although there was appreciation of this earlier scholarship. But knowledge evolves and changes, and more so where a shift of paradigm is involved, where the frame of reference is being realigned. The validity of periodizing history as Hindu, Muslim, and British was increasingly doubted. It had assumed a history of 2,000 years of a golden age for the Hindu period, 800 years of despotic tyranny for the second, the Muslim period, and a supposed modernization under the British. Such divisions set aside the relevance of significant changes within these lengthy periods. That any age stretching over such a long time can be described as consistently glorious or tyrannical, either way, was questioned. And also the characterization of an age merely by the behavior of rulers or by their religion. These doubts were encouraged when history became more than just the study of dynasties. There was also the realization that communities and religions are not monolithic, but were and are segmented and fragmented into sects and groups. Each of these sects had varying relationships with the other, and it is these relationships which have to be analyzed. The history of religions, ranging from social practice and ritual to belief and ideology, is complex. It has to be correlated with the history of those who constitute its patrons and its lay followers. Alternate notions of periodization, different from the colonial Hindu, Muslim, British, were in part a reaction to the opening up of a dialogue between history and other disciplines. Conventional history had juxtaposed the succession of dynasties, one more glorious than the next, with the bare bones of an economic history, a social history, the history of religion, the history of art, the history of literature, and so on. These were all included within the same chronological brackets, but were not integrated. There was a vertical and almost exclusive view of each aspect, kept distinctly separate in standard histories. However, by relating these aspects more closely to each other and to a common historical context, they provided a network of interconnected features which enabled us to understand the history of a period much better. This gave greater depth and meaning to that understanding. The interface between the past and the present encouraged the notion that earlier historical experience could provide insights into some contemporary conditions. Historians also began to look at the way in which other disciplines studied aspects of society. This was particularly useful, for instance, in trying to reconstruct societies from archaeological data. This was no longer limited to just making a list of all the objects that were found in excavations. And added to this came the study of linguistics, the analyzing, the pulling apart of a language and seeing how it was constructed and what contributed to the construction of the language. Coinciding with these changes was the establishing of other disciplines within the social sciences: economics, sociology, anthropology, human geography, demography, and so on, with a much needed focus on Indian problems as particular and specific. Ancient history moved from being merely a part of Indology, which was a portmanteau label, it applied to anybody that was studying any aspect of India, to becoming a social science and developing a new orientation of a different kind. There was the growing recognition that the past had to be explained, understood, reinterpreted on the basis of what historians began to refer to as a historical method based on critical inquiry. The reliability of the evidence and the logic of the argument continued to have the primacy that they had had earlier, but now there was a wider explanation of the historical context. The incorporation of evidence from archaeology and linguistics has been crucial in one controversy, for example, that has involved historians and many non-historians. This relates to the northwestern subcontinent in the 3rd and 2nd millennium BC. The controversy is over the identity of what have been called the Aryans. The earlier theory of an Aryan invasion has been totally discounted, and the scene is reconstructed differently. Mainstream historians maintain that there was contact and exchange between the settlements of the Northwest and the subcontinent and adjoining areas of Afghanistan and Central Asia in the second millennium BC. After the decline of the Harappan cities in about 1700 BC, there were small-scale migrations of people speaking an Aryan language who settled and mingled with local societies. And evidence of this is found broadly in the area that is today known as the Oxus Valley in Central Asia, in northeastern Iran, in northern Syria, and in northwestern India. There are some who would like to see the Harappans as the Aryans, so that the foundation of Indian civilization can be thought of as uniform, linear, going in a straight line back to the Aryans. And we may well ask, why is there this obsession with the Aryan? This was a 19th century notion. It was an obsession in Europe. Why do we carry on with this obsession in the 21st century in India? In the 19th century, the Aryans were seen as a race, an idea that is now totally discarded. Aryan is a language label and not a biological identity. Therefore, the linguistic evidence is extremely important. Indo-Aryan is a cognate, a sister language of other languages known from Anatolia and Iran, and these all date to the middle of the second millennium BC, around 1500, 1400 BC. They are currently thought to be earlier in linguistic form than the Indo-Aryan of the Vedic corpus. Therefore, it is plausible that some of these people migrated into northwestern India. The archaeology of this period suggests settlements of pastoralists and cultivators, and a familiarity with copper technology, iron technology coming much later. But opposed to this is the view that the Aryans are indigenous to India and that they were the authors of the Indus civilization, for which view there is virtually no evidence. Such a reconstruction that the Aryans were indigenous to India is also a reincarnation of colonial notions about the Indian past. It was Colonel Olcott, an American theosophist, and the theosophists in the 19th century, who first argued that India was the homeland of a group of people whom they called the Aryans. It appealed to the upper caste Hindus, who saw themselves as being the direct lineal descendants of these Aryans. And they also claimed a kinship connection with the British, a connection which is made by both Max Müller and Keshav Chandra Sen. There is even an echo of the theories of the very colorful Madame Blavatsky, that Aryan India was the cradle of world civilization and Indians traveled westwards, taking civilization with them. This kind of Aryan Indian identity, monolithic and uniform for all time, surfaces in some current political ideologies as well. My main contention is that since the evidence is so uncertain, the evidence changes each time there is an archaeological excavation, we can hold these theories, but please let's not battle over them. It is possible to explore the diverse dimension of social history from both the Vedic corpus and archaeology in more perceptive ways. In comparing archaeological and textual data, it is not enough to just compare lists of objects. It is necessary to examine the system of social functioning when trying to understand the cultures of these societies and their negotiations with each other. The roots of a civilization, Indian or any other, do not lie in a single identity, but in the multiple cultures that gave rise to the many societies of those and later periods. Examining how concepts and identities changed in history is basic to the study of cultural history. Other new ways of exploring the past brought about another kind of paradigm shift in historical writing. It involved using methods of analysis current in the social sciences. Historians in the 60s and 70s found themselves in dialogue with other social scientists, and this triggered off new directions in research. The challenge lay in history becoming an intellectual exploration as well as an understanding of the past. I would like to consider a few examples of the kind of historical themes that attracted historians of early India. These may illustrate the point that I'm making. The concept of the nation had been foremost in the anti-colonial movement. We were about to become a nation. What did the nation mean? The question was, how far back can it be taken? And then gradually a differentiation had to be made between the nation or the nation state as a contemporary development and the state as something that went back to early centuries. Put at its simplest, a state refers to the forms of governance of a territory and the people living there, whereas the nation implies at least an awareness of a shared past by the people who constitute the nation, and this sharing of a past is the investment in a shared future. For the pre-modern period, a centrally administered kingdom had been thought to be the norm for all states in all times. Everybody talked about kingdoms being highly centralized, their administration. And the argument went that when these kingdoms broke up, this was equated with political decline and was seen as the fragmentation of a polity accompanied by an absence of consolidated power. Empires were the order of the day, particularly with British historians who saw the British Empire as the successor, if not the reincarnation, of the great Roman Empire. The fashion caught on, and soon every important kingdom was labeled an empire. And even today, if you open many history books, you will read all about the Satavahana Empire, the Chalukya Empire, the this empire, the that empire. The study of political forms and the likelihood of variation in patterns of power gradually led to demarcating varying forms of politics. For example, during the earliest period, a differentiation has to be made between clan-based societies with chiefs, now referred to as chiefships, and the more familiar form of kingship. The transition from clan-based polities to kingdoms is a seminal notion to the study of societies as described in the Vedic texts, the Mahabharata, and the Ramayana. These were all clan societies slowly changing to kingdoms. Similarly, the Ganasangha is described in the Buddhist Pali canon. Chiefships, being agro-pastoral, are thought of as prior to kingship, which is based on plow agriculture. Kingdoms as state systems had a more complex administration with the focus of power all consolidated in one family. Historical analyses are, of course, complicated by the fact that these various forms do not move in a linear fashion, and they are not uniform in space and time. The questions being currently debated by historians relate to the social and economic reasons why and how societies change, the interfaces between the many cultures, and the manner of legitimizing power. In many ways, these are questions that are still relevant. All these are questions germane to the wider inquiries into the Indian past. When the structure of the state began to be discussed, it led to a focus on how a state comes into existence. What is state formation and what are the different types of states? The nature of the formation of states suggested variations. Thus, the Mauryan state of the 4th century BC was not identical with that of the Guptas, who ruled 800 years later in the 4th century AD. The nature of administration was again open to discussion. It can be asked whether the Mauryan Empire was a highly centralized bureaucratic system, as most of us have argued in our earlier writing, or can it be seen as a more diversified system, as some of us began to argue in our later writings. The tension between control from the center and the assertion of local autonomy has been a recurring feature and is now being commented upon. The regular use of the term empire for all kingdoms has come in for questioning, with kingdoms being differentiated from empire. Religion was an unlikely primary factor in the initial emergence of the state, since the state required more utilitarian resources. But in the welding of segments into an empire, as in the policies of Ashoka, the Mauryan ruler, or Akbar, the Mughal, there was recourse to certain facets of religion, among other things. And such facets need further analysis. Whereas previously Brahmanism was the ideology that was discussed in detail, now alternate systems of thought are also eliciting greater interest. Arguments and counter-arguments among intellectuals of those times were part of the urban experience. They all gathered in parks on the edges of towns and held public debates, the kind of thing I wish we could do now. Earlier studies had noted that orthodox views were challenged by the heterodox, and these people were referred to by the Brahmins as the Nastika, the unbelievers, and the Pashanda, the frauds. The so-called heretics, in turn, used the same terms for the Brahmins when the debate became rather fierce. Such discussions as, for example, the divergent views on social ethics are not only significant in themselves, but also in the analysis of the text within a social context. Philosophical ideas are not merely part of a sectarian religious discourse. They are an interrogation of knowledge, drawing on a spectrum of thought ranging from mysticism to logical rationality. From the colonial perspective, the primary economy of India was the agrarian economy. Comparatively, less interest was shown in the study of urban cultures. That is now receiving considerable attention. Urbanization in the Ganges Plain in the 6th centuries BC was linked to the emergence of state systems with attendant changes in technology and administration. The currently debated question is, what was the role of iron technology in the process of urbanization? Which is a very different question from what was asked 50 years ago. The investigation of the state as a process has focused on its location in terms of environment, resources, and demography, as well as its potential as a center for the exchange of goods and the hub of administration. This was partially influenced by the focused research on the much earlier Harappan cities. Exchange in varying forms, from barter to commerce, for which there is a spurt of evidence in the post-Mauryan period, 200 BC to 300 AD, provided an additional economic dimension. The study of coins as part of the economy introduced the first notions of looking at money and markets as exchange centers. A study of market centers in South India, for example, raises the question of whether commerce could have been an economic factor in the emergence of kingdoms amongst the Cheras, the Cholas, and the Pandyas. And this suggests a variant pattern. Closeness to other parts of Asia was known through overland routes. Maritime connections have now come to the forefront, underlining new cultural and intellectual intersections. The perspective on the Indian past, earlier viewed from the Himalaya and the Hindu Kush mountains of the north, is now being extended to include the very different perspective from the Indian Ocean to the south. Increasing evidence of maritime connections has also raised questions linked to complex commercial arrangements. In the period just prior to the European arrival in Asia, the commercial orbit of Afro-Asian trade ran from Tunis in North Africa to Canton in South China. There was a route that linked these places. The commerce crossed state boundaries and involved elements of what we today would call international trade and investments. Therefore, half-serious comments are being made by historians on globalization before globalization. But more seriously, this does question the validity of treating civilizations as autonomous and segregated and isolated, and instead recognizing them to be porous and interconnected. Historians in many parts of the world have discussed, and this is a new area of considerable interest in history, have discussed and continue to do so, the theories that explain and interpret historical events. In India, there has been, since the middle of the 20th century, an interest in the writings of Karl Marx, Max Weber, and the French sociologists and historians of the Annales school, since all of them had written on India. For Karl Marx and Max Weber, India was the immensely different other of Europe. Each provided alternate explanations for why India was thus completely different. And not only India, but they very often included Asia. Historians debated these explanations and are still doing so. And in the process, aspects of the past that had earlier seemed closed were becoming visible. And the discussion brought what were thought to be peripheral subjects, marginal subjects, right into the center of historical concerns. The centrality of social and economic history was evident in all these theories of explanations. This was a change from dynastic history. Marxist historical writing introduced the idea of what was called modes of production. Marx's notion of the Asiatic mode of production, which was a kind of variant of Oriental despotism, was rejected by Indian Marxists. So too was the slave mode of production. This had been based on studies of ancient Greece and Rome. And comparison with evidence from India was attempted, but the model was found to be unsuitable. However, the possibility of a feudal mode of production captured the attention of Indian historians. The notion of feudalism had initially drawn on European parallels, but now the discussion centered on the Marxist model. It is interesting that the critique of this feudal mode of production for India was also initiated by Marxist scholars. The argument was based on changes in land relations in the latter half of the first millennium AD in India. The transition to feudalism, it was argued, lay in the system of granting land or villages primarily to Brahmins, to temples, to Buddhist monasteries, and to a few who served the state. Since the granting of land became a focal point of the political economy, the parallel, as it were, to feudal holdings in Europe, since the it brought about a tangible change. This became central after about the 8th, 9th centuries AD, which makes it a time marker for a new periodization. The discussion for and against the feudal mode opened up new perceptions about the nature of the state, the economy, and society. Religious activities, as well as the more down-to-earth factors that determine agrarian systems, were also considered. And it also led to non-Marxist theories of state formation. Religious beneficiaries under this land grant system established institutions and became extremely powerful property holders, as in the case of the Buddhist and Jain monasteries and the Brahmanical mutts. And later on, of course, you had the same tradition continuing with the Sufi Khankas. Some religious sects that began as small local cults with a regional base, when their popularity increased and they received royal patronage, became a network of support for a particular dynasty. This process was to be common and visible in many regions of India. The Yadavas, for instance, in the Deccan, were both devotees and patrons of the emerging cult of Vitthala, a form of Vishnu, widely worshipped in Maharashtra and parts of Karnataka, and also very well known here in Goa. This is thought to have had its origins in the hero cult of local pastoralists. Royal patronage of a popular religious cult meant that the geographical distribution of the cult could become the area of support for the patron, and the overlap of religion and politics in that process becomes evident. Activities covered by the all-inclusive label of religion have often to be analyzed as social institutions in order to understand their function in a community. Religious organizations are not just religious organizations, they also play a social role. This helps to clarify the links between social roles and religious beliefs. Religious establishments, whether Buddhist, Jain, Vaishnav, or Shaiv, quite apart from their role in fostering formal religion, were sometimes channels of political intervention through their relationship with rulers. The patronage of kings can go from one sect to another, from the succession of one king to the next. Historians are sometimes left guessing as to the king's religious affiliation, although in most cases this is made clear. At the same time, popular religious movements, some known to deviate from or even contradict the orthodox, such as the Shakta and the Tantric sects in their early stages, occupied a prominent place on a wider social canvas. The many manifestations of what have been called the devotional religion or bhakti, or the Shakta sects, take varying social forms differing from one region to another. The variations provide insights into local connections and histories. Max Weber's idea of legitimacy as being essential to political authority is receiving increasing attention. Rituals, apart from their religious function, can also be statements of legitimacy and therefore a source of power. Historical traditions are sometimes created to satisfy the need for legitimation. Priests perform rituals to endow their patrons with status and with the promise of success. The patron acquires prestige, and the priest receives material wealth as a fee or a gift, the dakshina. Such relationships, based on what is called gift-giving, are not just demonstrations of generosity. They are, in effect, bonds of another kind between the donor and the recipient. Studies in the patterns of genealogies and lineages, as recorded in the epics and later in the inscriptions, are providing new insights into early societies. The lengthy lists of heroes and anti-heroes in various texts are being examined for new information, especially on a variety of social observances. For instance, one is repeatedly intrigued, by the polyandrous marriage of Draupadi in the Mahabharata. This raises many questions as to why there should have been this intense deviation from the normal rules. Caste, as studied by social anthropologists, has encouraged historians to ask similar questions, but from their entirely different sources. What was earlier thought to be the unchanging character of caste has given way to realizing that degrees of social mobility were possible, but not widely so, and involved imitating the lifestyle of the upper castes. This appears to be more apparent in what is referred to in the Purans as kings creating new kshatriyas. Politics was an open arena, as it still continues to be, and claims to kshatriya status as part of legitimation are frequent. The process was not always one of gentle osmosis. imitating upper caste lifestyles or being incorporated into the upper castes or contesting upper castes can be sometimes the cause of friction, if not aggression, as happens even today. The work on gender history has not been limited to just accumulating more data on the history of women, as in the past. It is now concerned with re-examining the position of women from various strata of society and social relationships. It is also searching for the perspective that women had of themselves in their society, a question that is seldom asked. For example, it was earlier stated that all women were held in high respect in ancient India. The evidence invariably quoted was that of the woman philosopher Gargi asking tough philosophical questions. But this evidence sits uncomfortably alongside references in the same texts to the substantial numbers of women domestic slaves, the Dasis, and these were women who were gifted as wealth, as is clear from the Rig Veda and the Mahabharata. They were regarded as chattel and as property. The Buddhist texts have statements about women complaining of their distinctly subordinate position. In the legal forms of marriage, in the Manu Dharma Shastra, for example, the woman becomes an object. She is either gifted, as in Kanyadana, or she is abducted, as in the Rakshas form, the form which is resorted to by Arjun in the Mahabharata. The historian's concern is to place these statements in the context of the particular societies where they occur, and thereby to try and understand the nature of that society. One of the important avenues of change was when clans mutated, got transformed into castes. This was a continuous and constant process in various parts of the subcontinent. The change was not simultaneous, and old forms sometimes remained as a parallel stream. But the origins of certain other castes can also be traced to non-caste groups who had previously had clan or occupational identities, such as forest dwellers or certain kinds of artisans. The cultural assimilation of clans often resulted in the chief's families taking on Kshatriya status and the rest of the clan being regarded as Shudras and becoming the peasants. A picture of this process can be glimpsed in the Harsha Charita of Banabhatta, a 7th century biography of King Harshavardhana of Kannauj. This social change required the converting of forest into fields and an erstwhile more egalitarian society having to accept the hierarchies of caste. And then a permanent supply of labor was ensured by using the caste structure and declaring that some groups and some occupations were so low and polluting as to make such people permanently untouchable. The explanations for this theory provide another dimension of social history. Historical explanations are now being extended to include a slow but growing interest in the landscape where events take place. What were the environmental factors, if any, in a changing situation? Thus, the decline of the Harappan cities is now more often explained by environmental factors, such as changing river courses or the desiccation of the area, than by invasions, environmental factors leading to the migration of people, which, if you argue there was a migration of Harappans to the outlying areas, raises all kinds of interesting historical questions as to what was the impact of this migration. The history of deforestation and how it changed the landscape and climate in many areas of the subcontinent over many centuries needs detailed study. Investigation of environmental factors has tended to highlight the history of the region where the change occurs. This brings one into the question of regional history. The interest in regional history grew by degrees, assisted to some extent by the creation of linguistic states from the late 1950s, superseding the more arbitrary boundaries of the erstwhile provinces of British India. The perspective of subcontinental history, conveniently viewed from the Ganges Plain, has had to change with the evidence now coming from various regional histories. For example, the history of South India is rightly much more prominent in general histories of India than it was 50 years ago. Regional histories form patterns that sometimes differ from each other. The variations provide interesting facets for the study of comparative history. For example, the model of the four varnas, the four castes, was not the caste pattern in the entire subcontinent, as was maintained earlier. We still have to explain why Brahmins and Velala peasants gave shape to the history of Tamil Nadu, as many historians think, whereas Khatri traders dominated in the north, in the Punjab. Differences such as these are not just diversities in regional styles. They are expressions of multiple cultural norms that cut across the assumption that all identities are and have always been monolithic and uniform. The reorientations that I have mentioned were anticipated as a consequence of interdisciplinary trends and of methodological change and discussions of the theories of explanation. Alongside this, they developed an interest in investigating how historians write history and where the intellectual influences on them may lie. This is encouraging the investigation of the history of ideas. One hopes that the early systems of thought and what are sometimes called proto-science and proto-philosophy will be explored, adding a further dimension to history by examining their impact on historical change. Let me now conclude by saying that if historical knowledge is to be meaningful, then the past has to be understood and explained. It is not enough just to get information from a source, whether it is an archaeological artifact or a text. It also has to be interpreted. This requires assessing the reliability of the evidence to begin with, and then asking a number of questions about its authorship, function, audience, and significance. This is particularly called for in the study of ancient history, since its very remoteness in time makes it somewhat difficult to grasp. There can be a thin line between what we like to believe happened and what the evidence is actually telling us. Historical knowledge, like all knowledge, is continually growing and changing, and this helps us to test our generalizations and clarify our understanding of the past. And questioning existing knowledge can help in delving deeper into possible explanations, and explaining the past justifies, it seems to me, the pursuit of history. Thank you.
We invite any questions or queries from the audience.
Madam, you mentioned that during the colonial period, the colonial historians had divided Indian history into three periods: Hindu period, the Muslim period, and the British period. But there was also another period which was very glorious, that lasted for about 1500 years, that is from the days of Ashoka till the destruction of Nalanda, about 1500 years. That was the Buddhist period. And it was the colonial scholars who helped us to decipher the Brahmi script, which helped us to read the Ashoka's edict. Now, the colonial historians, did they not mention anything about this Buddhist period? Because at that time, the social system was completely different. There was no caste system, because there is no place for caste system in Buddhist system, history. And India was the epicenter of all the knowledge in the entire, not only in the subcontinent, but the entire Asia at that time.
No, it wasn't the epicenter of all knowledge. That is something which is an exaggeration. Can you hear me? Okay. There is no Buddhist period because there were no Buddhists alive at that time. Remember, in the 19th century, Buddhism had died down and there were no Buddhists. When Didi Kosambi's father is looking for a Buddhist to teach him Pali, he goes all over the country. He cannot find anyone to teach him Pali or to teach him about Buddhism. Finally, he goes to the Mahabodhi Society in Calcutta and gets a ticket to go to Sri Lanka. And that's where he learns about it. So the British periodization, which was colonial policy trying to fit in the existing population, saw the Indian population only as Hindu and Muslim. So they talked about two periods. They didn't give any importance to the Buddhist contribution. And secondly, like many 19th and early 20th century Hindus as well, they saw Buddhism as an intrinsic part of Hinduism. They didn't realize that it was an alternative system. So Buddhism was not all that important in their thinking.
Ma'am, in your lecture, regional histories and the regional language histories came at the end of the lecture. But actually, even during the 30s and 40s, history writing was very much in vogue in various Indian modern Indian languages, and some of them had tried to write in all facets of history, including what the thing that you mentioned, for example, dana economy emanating from the kind of dana institution was there with yajnas and other things. Sridhar Venkatesh Ketkar, in his book on the ancient Maharashtra history, has given big chapters on these. And then there is critical evaluation, the language part, and every other aspect is dealt, even the ecology, environment, these aspects are also taken. These have not come only in the recent historical writings, but they were there in the regional languages far earlier also. This is what I want to make a point.
Yeah, the point that I was trying to emphasize was not that, I mean, there were regional histories actually written in the languages much earlier. I mean, those go back to the end of the 19th century. And then they continue, and some are even written in English. The point I was trying to make was that the importance of regional history today, one is, as you rightly say, that they're trying to find out the history of the region, and you go on investigating more and more, and you get more and more details of the history of the region. But the point I was making was that for the overall history of India, it is the comparative study of regions. The questions that you have to ask is, why are the patterns of regional history different? That is an issue which is now being taken up. And it's being now taken up because the kinds of questions that the social sciences are asking are entering regional history only in the recent decades. Prior to that, the kind of regional history that was written was the same as the kind of Indian history that was being written, which was really the accumulation of more and more data about chronology and about succession and narratives of events. But the analysis of society and economy, this is something which is relatively recent, and also the comparative aspect.
Madam, there is a feudal period which has been mentioned by Professor Kusambi, that's feudalism from up, the two processes which has explained, feudalism from above and feudalism from below. And this has been heavily debated and criticized and even not agreed, even by you and Professor R.A. Sharma.
I'm sorry, okay.
Slightly, let me.
Yeah, you finish.
Yes. You have not agreed on the entire process, but you have not even explained why you have a major differences about these two processes, of feudalism above and feudalism below. What is the difference of criticism or the difference between your agreement and Professor R.S. Sharma's agreement? What I would like to suggest is this. What in your explanation, you have not mentioned about the surplus which has been extracted from the peasantry during early, that's from the feudalism from above, and the surplus which was extracted with the intermediaries in the feudalism from below. So how you explain these differences between you and Professor Sharma and Professor Kusambi?
Well, I have said that I am more generally in agreement with Professor Kosambi, because I think that the process was a double process, where initially what he, as I understand him, I may have misunderstood him, but as I understand him, Dr. Kusambi is saying that feudalism from above is essentially, apart from where the collecting of the surplus may go, it is essentially the appointing of intermediaries. And it's these intermediaries that hold the whole system in their hands. Whereas this then changes as you begin to get much greater dependence of intermediaries on the production process at the level of the peasant. And then the production process produces the kind of surplus which is gathered by the intermediaries and largely retained by them, and not passed on to the overlord. That is feudalism from below. And I find that a very good explanation for this phenomenon that the intermediaries frequently become the overlords, they overthrow the overlords. So this circular turnover of the person in on top becoming the feudatory and the feudatory becoming the person on top is better explained, I think, by Professor Kosambi's thesis than by Professor R.S. Sharma, who sees it all as one process. So my difference of opinion is a little more with Professor R.S. Sharma rather than Kosambi. Yeah, I know. Historians haven't taken these two phases as worth studying. I mean, I'm sorry. If I was a specialist in feudalism, I would probably do it, but I'm not. No, it's not a question of being part of ancient. It's a question of whether you're interested in that particular historical process. I happen not to be interested in the process of feudalism.
I'm sure we want to know much more, but due to time constraints, we have to wind up the session here itself. An afternote for such an effective, enlightening, and enchanting masterpiece is definitely not required. But all I could say is, ma'am, it was not a mere lecture, but a lifetime experience to hear you speak. Thank you so much. I'm fortunate to convey to you the gratitude each and every one is feeling towards you. Moving ahead, I would now welcome the respected president for today's function, Honorable Governor Shri Bharatveer Vanchu, to kindly address today's dignitaries and guests.
Professor Romila Thapar, eminent historian, Dr. Satish R. Shettye, Vice Chancellor, Goa University, Dr. Maria Kuto, Chair, Standing Committee on Visiting Professor Scheme, Honorable MLA, Professor Kamath, Registrar, Professor Bhatt, Dean, Faculty of Social Sciences, Principals, members of the faculty, teachers, ladies and gentlemen, my dear students. At the outset, I would like to express my deep sense of appreciation and gratitude to Professor Romila Thapar for agreeing to spare her most valuable time to visit our university and for delivering such an enlightening address on contours and reading early Indian history, which was indeed not only informative, but highly thought-provoking. I'm indeed overwhelmed at having to speak after such a scholarly and scintillating talk, and would therefore keep it short. Professor Romila Thapar, as we all know, is very well known and recognized as an erudite scholar of India's history and has written several books on the subject, which serve as a rich treasure of information and knowledge, not only all over India, but across the globe as well. The notable literary works penned by Professor Romila Thapar are an expression of our nation's past history and wisdom, the knowledge of which is very important for our present and future generations. We can find the works of Professor Romila Thapar occupying a place of prominence in our universities and other libraries. However, in the current times of instant information gratification via the internet and numerous other channels, our new generation needs to be reminded and motivated to read these valuable books, which would serve them well to understand the intricacies of our national ethos and background. I would thus advise our students, as well as others, to spend some time in the study of such important works and benefit from the wealth of knowledge and information contained in them. I would like to compliment Goa University and the Vice Chancellor for assiduously pursuing this visiting professorship scheme. I would be failing in my duty if I do not place on record my deep appreciation of the tireless efforts and commitment of Dr. Maria Kuto and the committee in taking this scheme forward and launching it with none other than Professor Romila Thapar. The presence of Professor Romila Thapar here in Goa University is not only for our students, but also for our faculty, a matter of great honor and inspiration. I would call upon our students and also our faculty to seize upon this opportunity of her presence here to enrich themselves intellectually. I'm reminded of William Hazlitt, who said, and I quote, "A scholar is like a book written in a dead language. It is not everyone that can read it," unquote. The students of Goa University and the faculty are therefore blessed by the presence of Professor Romila Thapar in their midst, and I'm sure that they would take advantage of her presence and imbibe some of her wisdom, as it is education alone that can lead our country out of the dark days. If the students, and more particularly the faculty, can absorb from Professor Romila Thapar some of her wisdom and scholarly traits, and perhaps more importantly, her high values, we would achieve in large measure what we intend to by way of the visiting professorship scheme. Friends, history helps us to know our past and understand its linkage with the present and the foreseeable future. As someone said, the very concept of history implies the scholar and the reader. Without a generation of civilized people to study history, to preserve its records, to absorb its lessons, and relate them to its own problems, history too would lose its meaning. It therefore goes without saying that every generation should necessarily understand, appreciate, and assimilate a systematic account of the history of their nation, which should be objective and dispassionate. A responsibility is therefore cast on our educational institutions to transmit knowledge of our history to our succeeding generations, whether it is cultural history, social history, or the history of sciences. Everything that happens in the world becomes part of history. But history, we need to ensure, is not distorted or discarded, as that would be self-destructive. Let me remind you that history is not merely an account of wars and struggles between kings and kingdoms, but is also peace, security, justice, as well as innovations and improvements in the life of mankind from time to time. It is indeed a matter of joy and satisfaction for us that our country has produced eminent and erudite men and women who not only loved history, but passionately contributed to its enrichment through extreme hard work and perseverance. Professor Romila Thapar is undoubtedly one of our leading scholars, and it would be appropriately to say about her scholarly traits, as someone aptly said, "It is the unknown that excites the order of scholars. Who in the known alone would shrivel with boredom?" Universities stand for dissemination of knowledge and wisdom to the new generation and to ensure continuity of this process for the benefit of society. India was a major seat of learning during ancient times. Our country has inherited a rich tradition of knowledge and learning, which has immensely benefited successive generations. Unfortunately, however, we have in the modern times lost our preeminent position in the field of education and learning, and need to do a lot more to improve the quality of education in our country so as to regain our lost glory. The 21st century, you would all agree, is the age of knowledge and information, which to my mind should serve us significantly in helping solve many of the problems and challenges like poverty and illiteracy being faced by our country. The time has come when we should seriously attempt to integrate higher education with the socioeconomic and cultural needs of our country. Our universities should act as active partners and mediators in the process of socioeconomic progress of the people and should be capable of addressing many of the developmental needs and problems facing our society. I am happy that Goa University has launched this novel scheme of visiting professorship in order to facilitate interaction between eminent scholars of our country and our faculty and students. I'm pleased that we have an impressive list of reputed and renowned scholars from different fields. Our faculty and students would thus get an opportunity to rub shoulders with several intellectual giants in the next three academic years. We must remember that the process of dissemination of knowledge is unending, and we need to take full advantage of this scheme. Acquisition of new knowledge should be the motto of everyone. We can no more live in closed societies and be ignorant of the changes and progress that is happening around the world. Today, the world is shrinking into a global village. The knowledge emerging in one part of the world is spreading across the entire globe. Our teachers and students in Goa should make all-out efforts to update their information and knowledge on a regular basis in order to make our education system more relevant and in tune with changing times. I would like to thank the Vice Chancellor and the University Administration for their initiative and innovative approach in launching this program, which I am confident will prove to be very successful and useful. To our students, for whose benefit this scheme has been launched, I would like to say that in order to succeed, your desire for success should be greater than your fear of failure. I would also like to say that learning is a process. It comes in incremental stages, but rarely all at once. And the secret to mastery in any field is to forever be a student. In today's scenario, while we always stress on discipline and hard work, I would like to say to our students, as someone once said, study hard what interests you the most in the most undisciplined, irreverent, and original manner possible. I once again thank Professor Romila Thapar for having been gracious enough to visit us and deliver such an illuminating address. I would like to conclude by describing Professor Thapar by quoting Nelson Mandela, who once said, and I quote, "A good head and a good heart are always a formidable combination. But when you add to that a literate tongue or pen, then you have something very special," unquote. Thank you. Jai Hind.
Thank you, sir. I now request Professor V.P. Kamath, respected Registrar, Goa University, to kindly present the vote of thanks.
Honorable Governor of Goa and Chancellor of Goa University, Sri B.B. Vanchu, distinguished speaker of today's function, Professor Romila Thapar, Vice Chancellor of Goa University, Dr. Satish Shetye, Professor Yan Shambhat, Dean, Faculty of Social Sciences, members of various university bodies, faculty deans, heads and faculty members of university teaching departments, principals and teachers from affiliated colleges, officers and other members of the university staff, invitees, distinguished citizens, members of the press and electronic media, dear students, ladies and gentlemen. It's my proud privilege to propose the vote of thanks on this august occasion of launching the visiting chair professorship scheme at Goa University with the inaugural lecture delivered by none other than most revered personality in academic sphere, Professor Romila Thapar. I take this opportunity to express our profuse gratitude and sincere thanks to Sri B.V. Vanchu, Honorable Governor of Goa and Chancellor of Goa University, for his esteemed presence amongst us and for presiding over the function. The valuable thoughts that he has expressed on this occasion will no doubt serve our university in good stead as we enter the 29th year of our establishment. Thank you, sir, for your encouraging words, sagacious advice, and guidance. The inauguration of the visiting research chair scheme by Professor Thapar's scholarship has really touched the heights that were aimed at when the project was initially envisaged. On behalf of the Vice Chancellor, students, and my colleagues at the university, I convey our gratitude and heartfelt thanks to Professor Romila Thapar for accepting our invitation and consenting to come down to Goa to deliver the lecture today. Madam Thapar's erudite presentation has truly set the benchmark for a series of resourceful and illuminating discourses under this visiting chair professorship scheme instituted at the university. In addition, it will provide our social science students and researchers a sense of direction and much food for thought. Once again, madam, our sincere thanks to you for your gracious presence amidst us today. We are deeply indebted to Madam Maria Arora Couto, honorary member of the Executive Council and chairperson of the Standing Committee for Visiting Chair Professorship, as well as the other members of the committee for their painstaking trouble in identifying the most appropriate and distinguished personalities for extending the invitation under this novel scheme supported liberally by the Government of Goa. Today's inaugural lecture is a testimony to their splendid efforts, and accordingly, it is my privilege to thank you, Madam Couto, and your team on behalf of all those who are present here today. The Goa University is ever obliged to the Government of Goa for its visionary decision to initiate the chair professorship scheme and the magnanimity in sanctioning 6 other chairs, cherishing the fondest memories of our distinguished fellow Goans. Our special thanks go to the Directorate of Art and Culture for unstinted support in providing the much required guidance in terms of finalizing the operational aspects of organization. Our special thanks are also due to all the distinguished dignitaries in the audience who spared their valuable time to be with us this afternoon. I would also like to express my sincere thanks to the chairman and members of the core committee constituted to coordinate this event, members of various university bodies, members of the university staff, the principal, students, the faculty members, and all our esteemed guests, and also members of the press and electronic media for accepting our invitation to be with us this evening. Our kind words of appreciation also go to the Goa State Infrastructure Development Corporation for readying this beautiful auditorium to arrange this function. Finally, I solicit your continued support and encouragement to march forward in our quest for knowledge. Thank you once again.